Naomi Halas knows how guys think. Her ranch in Texas is way, way outside Houston in brush country, so it's a little hard to find, but as it happens...
One of our neighbors used to be was a former penthouse pet, so she was a bit of a local celebrity.
So whenever Naomi needed lumber or whatever delivered, all she had to say to the delivery guy, any delivery guy apparently, was,
"Do you know where the stripper lives?" And they would all know. And so rather than going into long detailed directions, all I'd have to do is say, "Well, we're about 200 yards past the stripper on the left."
The ranch is for weekends. During the week, Naomi Halas is a professor at Rice University teaching nanotechnology and applied physics, fields that are 90% dominated by men. But not here, not in her group. If you look around, it's about even, which is different for guys.
What else could I say?
And very different for women.
Being a woman has actually never been an issue for me in this group. You just forget about it, which is nice. It's a nice feeling because a lot of people aren't that lucky.
So how'd this happen? How'd Naomi create such an unusual balance? Even her husband, this is Peter, he joins the group, not as the leader, he's just one of the gang.
This is an event.
Well, there's a story here.
You know, the best science stories are told backwards, okay? So
let's go back a bit. When Naomi was growing up, yeah, that's her, and so is this, she never thought about becoming a scientist, even in high school.
I remember very clearly in high school, although I was always at the top of my class in math and science, I was told don't take physics. And the reason I was told not to take physics was because if I ever took physics, I would never get a date.
So she didn't take physics, she became a musician. And one day she was wondering where sounds came from, and a friend said, well, acoustics requires calculus.
But of course you've taken calculus, haven't you? And it just kind of hit me like a load of bricks. In fact, I hadn't taken calculus. I'd actually bought into this myth that maybe I probably wasn't going to be very good at math.
But she was good. So at 20, she decided, you know what? I'm going to drop music and switch to something science-y.
I thought, well, maybe I want to retool my career.
But what about her, you know, her feminine problem?
No, I didn't have.
Sorry. However you say that.
I didn't have a feminine problem.
In other words, you weren't embarrassed to do ungirlish stuff.
No, I was really butch, actually.
So she switched from music to chemistry, and then interestingly, chose a female-friendly graduate program at Bryn Mawr.
Bryn Mawr was certainly a place where women were 100% accepted.
And that's where she got her MA and PhD in physics, and she married.
Have you thought about doing that? Or
and when she joined the faculty at Rice University, Naomi found herself increasingly attracted by the world of the very, very small, the nano world.
This is a vial of gold nanoparticles, solid gold nanospheres.
They're so small you can't see them. They're little clumps of gold atoms. But if you could invent a clump that's hollow inside, it'll absorb a different color of light. And by changing the thickness of the gold shell, you can make it absorb whatever color you want. So look, here, what was once ruby red is now clear. Naomi's work was new and very interesting to graduate students. Well, men, women...
For the first 6 years, I had no women whatsoever. And then I had one. And once I had her, I became okay, and then lots of other women began to join my group.
Which was at first kind of unusual.
We're changing that. It won't be unusual for long.
Women told women, this is a good group. Naomi says, you know, I never planned this.
It just seems to sort of happen. Maybe having all these women attracts the men.
So in the end, she gets a balance. But the growing gang of women at Rice were at first invisible.
For most of my scientific career, I didn't publish with my first name in the paper. I was always N. Halas. So many people knew about my work and had no idea I was a woman because they read my work in literature.
But when Naomi and her colleagues created nanoshells by manipulating atoms, then the world noticed. The New York Times, Popular Science, Profiles. Nanoshells made Naomi and her lab famous. And yet, even as a tenured professor,
Doggies.
Plus by now she'd bought the ranch, as successful as she was, one day when she was presenting her findings at a meeting at Rice,
a man walked up to me and in a very loud voice said, "Excuse me, are you the lady in charge of the coffee?" And when I heard that, I just turned around and I walked back to my office and I just sat there and, you know, I almost burst into tears. This is ridiculous. I don't want to have, is it for the rest of my life, I'm going to be mistaken for somebody who's in charge of the coffee. And then I said, no, I think I will go back there because I don't want that person to win. I want to participate in this forum, and I don't care if he thinks I'm in charge of the coffee. So I went back.
And the contact she made at that meeting led to a business, which she started with biology professor Jennifer West, and they are now injecting nanoshells into animals with cancer. So here, just for fun to demonstrate, we're using a chicken breast. The nanoshells will gather inside the tumor.
And once they're in place, then light is shined through the skin and down into the tumor site.
Warming up the nanoshells so they burn the tumor. That's the steam here.
And that's sufficient to kill the cells in the tumor.
So without radiation, with light, you can attack cancer sites.
That's incredibly non-invasive if you consider other types of cancer therapies.
These therapies are still being tested by the women and the men who have gathered around Naomi. But the women, she says, even now, have to struggle to stay in the game.
I always thought it was a generational thing. I always thought, well, when I was a young scientist, I thought, oh, those are the older people, they're like that. But when I'm older, then people won't be like that anymore. But they are.
Too often, female grad students drop out, lose confidence, struggle to balance children and family. Naomi, I noticed, does not have children, which made me wonder if that's about work.
No, I cannot have children.
Oh.
So it's not that we didn't try. I am absolutely, I mean, that's another thing that people sometimes do look at someone who's childless and say, well, you know, you like science more than, you know, children and flowers and, you know, things like that, you know, but no, I like kids too.
So what she doesn't like is that half the kids, all the girls, still have trouble making the life that she has made. That struggle isn't over.